All right, Jim, thank you very much. And it is once again a thrill and indeed a humbling privilege for all three of us, and I think especially for me, to get to narrate this great spectacle in sports. No event as large and dramatic as the Indianapolis 500 would be without a wealth of compelling stories. As we've already told you, have the continuing biography of A.J. Foyt, Mario Andretti's bid to end 17 years of freakishly bad racing luck in Indianapolis, all the difficulties that the crews and the drivers have had in keeping these cars off the walls. And in fact, there will be many more which will emerge during the next few hours. And time now to collect the final thoughts of our two motor racing experts as we get ready to call the race. First, Sam Posey, who's been with us here at Indy since 1974. Sam, what's on your mind?
Well, Jim, you know, I've been coming to this race for 25 years, and I've loved it, and I've studied it. And let me tell you this. Never before has there been a front row as strong as this one. Ever. Andretti, Ray Hall, Mears. Each has won the race, and each is today on the top of his form. And fascinatingly, each is very different, representative of the decade, mirror of the decade in which he first won this race. I think of Mario Andretti. I think of the passion and the idealism of the 1960s, of a young Italian immigrant sailing by the Statue of Liberty, but bringing with him that fiery Italian spirit with which he still drives today. Rick Mears, who came to prominence in the 70s, the Californian in Bakersfield, playing with his motorcycles in the desert, laid back. Even today, he'd rather watch the race come to him. Bobby Rahal, the driver of the 80s, the college grad, the businessman with his briefcase and his glasses, the guy who even now as he is racing is planning ahead for his career after racing. I can't wait to see the start of this race.
I can't either, Sam, and of course, we might expect that if all three of those cars or even two of them could stay in the hunt for a long time, we could have a fast race, as was the case last year. But it's a privilege now to welcome to our commentary team this man, Bobby Unser, who won the race three times. And Bobby, behind the front row, what about the rest of the field?
Well, number one, Jim, I think the front row is going to probably take off early in the race and lead the race early on. But behind that, there's a lot of apprehension going on within the drivers. There's been a lot of wrecks this year, approximately 25 wrecks in practice. And I really think that there's a lot of concern, a lot of feeling among the drivers, some of them even possibly a little bit scared about the turbulence in the air from the cars ahead of them. The air is what we call dirty air, meaning the aerodynamics on the car don't work so well. And I think we have a lot of that. I think there's a lot of worry going on, so I think there's going to be a lot of separation in the cars between the guys that go for it in the front and the guys in the back that are trying to feel their way around a little bit.
And indeed, when you see drivers like Emerson Fittipaldi and A.J. Foyt hit the wall as they did in the last practice before the race, you know that there are extreme problems, all of them related to the handling of the car. And here now with Sam Posey, a lighthearted look at a subject that has been increasingly important.
As any chef, amateur or professional, knows, the recipe in the cookbook is just the beginning. It's up to you to give it life. Ingredients, preparation, stirring, seasoning, the right heat, the right timing. You must bring to the dish your own particular magic.
Like the chef, the chief mechanic of a racing team begins with a list of basic ingredients, all of which are adjustable. For each, there is a measurement or a setting with which he begins. For example, you might start by setting the front wing angles at, say, 2 degrees. From there, it's up to the chief mechanic to blend and mix these ingredients to form a combination that suits the particular taste of his driver.
If the mixture isn't absolutely perfect, here's what you see on the racetrack. A car so unstable that, as the drivers say, it's about to bite you. During the race, we'll discuss many of these terms, but keep in mind that everything interacts with everything else. If you soften a sway bar, you may need to stiffen the spring. A pinch more wing angle may call for a dash more shock absorber.
Of course, only the driver can really tell if his car is handling right or not. And of course, as we know from the crashes, many of them are not.
And amid all this uncertainty, can you have any instinct as to who might win the race?
Well, it has to be somebody from that front row, and I'm picking Mario Andretti. He's overdue. You know, you think part owner of his team is Paul Newman, and Paul finally won an Oscar that I think he's deserved for a long time, and maybe that's an omen. Mario would hate to hear me talking this way because he is very superstitious. doesn't like his crew to predict success for him, and in fact won't let them even buy champagne. But I'd like to say one other thing. Today may be notable for the first appearance at Indy of a young man named Davy Jones, a protege for A.J. Foyt, and I'd like to mention his name now.
All right, so you think Davy Jones may make a splash. What about your outlook, Bobby?
I think the most foolish thing in the world is to predict a winner at the Indianapolis 500. I think it's that way more so this year than any year we've had. Heat has been playing such a big factor. The radial tires have been playing such a big factor this month. There's been so many variables. Rookies, car problems with the 87 marches, so many problems, you can't pick a winner.
All right, so that is the outlook of our racing experts, and now let's go back to Jim McKay for some of the most compelling pageantry in American sport.
All right, Jim. The moment really does grow closer now. You know, sometimes we forget in the excitement of the approaching race that this is a national...